Welcome, everyone, to another week's episode of Encounter with God Together, our weekly audio and video podcast, where we go over the readings for the coming week in our Encounter with God daily Bible reading guide. And each week, I welcome a guest who gives their perspective on the coming week to kind of tee it up. And today, I'm happy to have with me Adrian Brown. Adrian is a familiar face to the Scripture Union family, having volunteered for a number of outreaches and programs, as well as offering his talents in music and more recently, some of your drawing talents to Scripture Union resources. And Adrian, it's great to have you here with us this week.
Thank you, Gail. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I've given you easy passages.
Not really.
But I'm looking forward to hearing what you have heard from the Lord, and I'm going to pray for you now. Father, I do thank you for Adrian, for his love of your word, for his commitment to you, and his gifting that has been used in our Scripture Union resources. And I pray now that as he tackles some even unpleasant chapters, hard chapters, that you will speak through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Excellent. Well, I'm going to turn it over to you to get going. And I know you've made a presentation, so let me know when you want me to pop that up on the screen.
Great. I would actually like that up on the screen now.
Okay. There we go.
So this word I love is Godfidence. It's a new word added in vocabulary of evangelical Christians today. And what this word means is putting your trust in God and not in false idols or false gods of this world today. Now, there is a passage that I would like to start off reading, Psalm 75, 1 through 4, for the director of music to the tune of Do Not Destroy, the Psalm of Asaph, a song. We praise you, God. We praise you, for your name is near. People tell of your wonderful deeds. You say, I choose the appointed time. It is I who judge with equity. When the earth and all its people quake, it is I who hold its pillars firm. To the arrogant, I say, boast no more. And to the wicked, do not lift up your horns. I love verse 4 in that. To the arrogant, I say, boast no more. So this is really giving a warning about the boasters, the wicked generations, which we'll see in Jeremiah 46 through 50, the wicked nations, the nations who did not put their trust in the Lord. And like Gail said in the beginning, it's not a very easy passage. They're not easy verses and chapters, both in the places and the many different contexts culturally to understand, but also in the messages that and the hard reality that these nations have to deal with now because they didn't put their trust in the Lord. But before we look at these readings, these chapters talk about biblical places and contexts that look very different on today's world map than in the map of biblical times. So if I were to, let's say in New York, ask somebody randomly on the street, hey, excuse me, can I just interview you for a second? Where do you think the land of the Ammonites is located? They probably wouldn't have a clue as to how to answer that, especially since the historic map has changed since biblical times. But if you ask somebody, where is Egypt? Now, they could answer, oh yeah, that country is on the northeast corner of Africa. Well, to understand the locations of Jeremiah 46 through 50, northeast of Egypt is where the lands of Israel, the West Bank, and the Gaza Strip are all located today. And east of Gaza is where the country of Jordan is. And in the northern part of Jordan is where the Ammonites were located. So now you see on the screen that I've divided up today's lands with biblical times. So right
underneath, helpful. Thank you.
Yeah, I added some people in different colors to represent the different parts. So right underneath the land of the Ammonites was the kingdom of Moab, and the northern land would be almost bordering east of the West Bank today, while Philistia would be where the Gaza Strip is today, which is close to Egypt. And we've recently heard many updates about southern Gaza in the current Israel-Hamas war. So these chapters take place near that region. To the right of Jordan is Iraq, and almost the center of Iraq is where Babylon was. In biblical times, the kingdom of Judah's capital was Jerusalem. Now the city of Jerusalem is located in modern day Israel. Damascus is where Syria is today, which is right between Jordan and Iraq. And biblical Elam is in southwestern Iran, while biblical Edom is in southwestern Jordan. So in Jeremiah 46 through 50, it encompasses these regions. So it's divided into two parts. So Jeremiah 46 through 48 is about God's judgment against Egypt, Philistia, and the kingdom of Moab, which these are the nations that are surrounding Judah. While Jeremiah 49 through 50, so now you can see that contrast there, is about God's judgment against Babylon and the nations surrounding Israel. Now, this includes Damascus, Elam, Hazor in Judah, and Kedar in Samaria. So quick note, Lot's daughters both had sons through their father. So when we think of Lot's daughters, do we think of a functional family per se today? Well, with their father, they actually had sons through their father, but it wasn't it was to preserve the generational line. So today it wouldn't seem functional, but based on the circumstances, they were trying to preserve their lines. So these sons, Moab and Ben-Ammi and their ancestors, these are the ancestors of the Moabites and the Ammonites. So that's cool to see. Now, in this slide, to start with the nations surrounding Judah, let's look at Egypt. So there was a battle against two different empires, and Judah was smack in the middle of this battle. And during the battle, the Egyptians planned to pass through the kingdom of Judah. And we can see that the blue is Judah here. But the Judean king Josiah refused for them to do so. So no passing.
That's great.
So thanks. When Pharaoh Necho met Josiah, he killed him. So I didn't make it that graphic there, but you can see that, yeah, he's dead now. And the Egyptians worshipped idols. So these are some of the ancient Egyptian deities. The Lord in Jeremiah 46 is warning of Egypt's coming judgment because of idolatry and because of disobedience. So in the ancient world, the idea of local deity was very popular. So while the Egyptians had their gods, Babylon had their gods, and Syria had its gods, and the list continues. However, the true God of Israel made it clear that he is himself is not a local deity, but he is the one true God, the God who reigns the universe. Jeremiah 46, 2 through 12 presents an announcement by Jeremiah that Egypt would fall into the hands of the Babylonians. This was after Pharaoh of Egypt was defeated by the king of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar. And do we think of another story where King Nebuchadnezzar is? It's a very famous story. For those of you who are watching, if you think about the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, definitely that comes to mind. So this prophecy was also during the fourth year of the reign of Josiah's son, who was named Jehoiakim. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar was the Lord's appointed ruler, but not like King Josiah or King David, because King David and Josiah were appointed to bring encouragement and protection for the Lord's people. But God used Nebuchadnezzar to bring punishment to those who were disobedient and idolatrous. So when we think about Nebuchadnezzar's name, that's a hint in the Bible that you know that trouble is coming. So now Jeremiah 46, verse 3 states, "Prepare your shields, both large and small, and march out for battle. Harness the horses, mount the steeds." So steeds, this means to prepare the war animals. "Take your positions with helmets on. Polish your spears, put on your armor." So does this look like that things are repeating a bit? Because to me, it looks like that there's a lot of repetition going on here. So repeated indications here that Jeremiah is warning the Egyptians to prepare for battle. So if they haven't prepared, then he's telling them harness. And if they still haven't listened, take your positions. So these repeated indications are for the purpose. Just wake up. it kind of reminds me of those cartoons where, like, you know, one alarm clock doesn't work. And then what happens? Then there's another alarm clock, and then like a third one and things like that. So basically, in the announcement, verse 11 continues the word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah, speaking to Egypt, stating, "You try many medicines in vain. There is no healing for you. The nations will hear of your shame. Your cries will fill the earth. One warrior will stumble over another. Both will fall down together." Boy, that sure sounds like what happens in Jeremiah 46 through 50, right?
Yeah.
It definitely is this foretelling. And I don't know if, I'm sure, Gail, you have like people that like have the gift of prophecy. But these days, like, it's definitely not seen as it was in Jeremiah's time. Like when there was a prophet, like they not only spoke, I know that there are prophets today that will say, the Lord will grant you favor in your life and things like that. But he really spoke specifically about very specific things here. But this repetition can be seen in the Psalms as well. So, Gail, could you read those three lines, the first three lines of just those three bullets there, starting with blessed?
Sure. "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers."
Yes. And from what it looks like, does it look like that there in the Psalms, like I know that we've read the Psalms before, but does it seem like things like are like always new, or that there are like repeating parts in the Psalms sometimes? Do you ever see like Psalms that repeat? Then Psalm 1, definitely I think of this, because this is actually a biblical Hebrew poetry of repetition, termed parallelism by biblical scholars, and is for a specific purpose. So this purpose is also used by Jeremiah, as well as David. Jeremiah is a very important prophet in the Bible, and God uses Jeremiah to warn of many destructions, including in Jeremiah 5. This is a very significant chapter too, for Jeremiah uses repeated indications that he cannot find a righteous person in Jerusalem. As God is speaking through him, Jeremiah says, "Run to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem, see now and know, and see in her open places." That's another further point. If you can find a man, if there is anyone who executes judgment, who seeks the truth, that's another further point in the passage, "and I will pardon her." So This reminds me of Romans 3, 10 through 12. There is no one righteous, not even one, right? And that, for me, when I was younger, that was a very hard chapter to swallow. Just the fact that you would think that with so many people in the world, now 8 billion people about, or even more, you would think that there would be one person who would be righteous, but there's not even one. And this is the dilemma that Jeremiah faces here. So in the same way, in Jeremiah 46, there is a lot of repeated language for a purpose to make the point that the Egyptians will face judgment.
Mm.
Now, Jeremiah 47 warns of the judgment upon Philistia before Pharaoh attacked Gaza. So again, the Lord gives Jeremiah this incredible gift of prophecy, and the Lord shows Jeremiah exactly what will happen. God is saying that the people of Philistia, or the Philistines, will be destroyed, and he is saying this through Jeremiah. So verse 4 states, "For the day has come to destroy all the Philistines." And then verse 5 states, "Gaza will shave her head in mourning," mm-hmm. which is poetic language, meaning that the people of Gaza will be mourning in this terrible day of judgment. Mm-hmm. Now, the Philistines are being destroyed because the Philistines are the ancient enemies and rivals of Israel. And we know this from the story of David and Goliath. And very on an interesting note, even secular context will largely reflect upon David and Goliath, and even in businesses like David and Goliath principles as well, that, you know, like the small one reigns victoriously, but there is a great purpose in this. And Goliath was a Philistine giant, and David and his brothers were from Israel. So in Jeremiah 47, the Philistines are still not obeying the Lord. You would think that when a huge giant is slain, that they would have learned their lesson, but apparently not. So Jeremiah 48 warns of the judgment that will come upon Moab. So was Moab a good and prosperous nation? Well, unfortunately not. Moab was a wicked and idolatrous nation. And the Moabites' god, Chemosh, was a national god. Now, Moloch there because it reminded me of this, because this god Chemosh was also connected with children's sacrifices, unfortunately. So during the 9th century BC, the kingdom of Moab had been subdued by the kingdom of Israel during the rule of the kings Omri and Ahab. Now, Ahab was very wicked. In fact, his wife was Jezebel. So the Moabite king during the 9th century BC was King Mesha, and he used to bring the king of Israel 100,000 lambs and all these different animals, but then he rebelled against the king of Israel, who was at that time Jehoram. So 2 Kings reports that Mesha sacrificed a child to his god Chemosh, so he believed in child sacrifices, which really reminded me of the sons and daughters sacrificing to the idols of Canaan. So put that there as it reminded me of that.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Now, we've covered God's judgment against the surrounding nations of Judah, which is Egypt, Philistia, and Moab. Now, in Jeremiah 49 through 50, now we see that contrast again. This is God's judgment against Babylon and the nations surrounding Israel. So Babylon had long enough captivated and made people do what they wanted to do. And now Babylon is now getting the punishment. So Pastor David Guzik makes the point that since the Ammonites lived on the east side of the Jordan River, this is why the capital of Jordan today is Ammon, which is very interesting. So we talked about Jehoiakim, since the Ammonites were often in conflict with Israel as they opposed Judah. So I drew swords there during Jehoiakim's reign. They also joined in the invasion of Judah in 602 BC. The Ammonites occupied lands that God had in mind for Israel. So they came and squashed Israel's land. So Jeremiah 49 through 50 warns of the judgment of the nations surrounding Israel and Babylon because of these nations not obeying the Lord's will and because the Babylonians worshiped their own gods rather than the one true God. Mm. So the Lord makes some questions for the Ammonites and Edomites through Jeremiah. So I want to, and that's the judgment too. So these questions, okay, so in these questions, are they questions that the Lord is wondering or are they more rhetorical questions? These look like rhetorical questions to me because in Jeremiah 49:1, has Israel no sons? Has he no heir? It shall become an outcome for the land of the Ammonites, contrasts a little bit with Edom too, because for the Ammonites, it shall become a desolate mound and its villages shall be burned with fire. Now in Jeremiah 49:7, has counsel perished from the prudent? Has their wisdom vanished? So the Lord is using these questions for this effect, and the land of Edom's outcome, it will be a land of horror. And basically this reminds me of like some sort of haunted land, basically. So everyone who passes by it will be horrified and will hiss because of all its disasters. And the chapter continues, behold, like a lion coming up from the jungle of the Jordan against a perennial pasture, which means a long-lasting pasture. The Lord continues, I will suddenly make him run away from her. And Damascus will have pains like a woman in labor, it says. And Kedar and Hazor is warned by the Lord in verse 30 to flee. It says, flee, wanderer, far away. Dwell in the depths, O inhabitants of Hazor, declares the Lord. For Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, has made a plan against you and formed a purpose against you. Now, what other verse talks about plans of prospering and not harming? Jeremiah 29. So this sounds like a reversal of Jeremiah 29:11, when it says that the king of Babylon has made a plan against you and formed a purpose against you. But how can this happen? How can there be a reversal of Jeremiah 29 for anyone? Isn't this verse for everyone? For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. This verse was a promise for everyone in every circumstance, right?
Well, is that a rhetorical question?
This is going to be a hard pill to swallow.
Yeah.
Because the answer we want to hear is yes.
Right.
But the real answer, I would not say the real answer, it requires an uncovering of more layers than a simple yes or no can provide. That's what I would say.
Yeah. And
John Piper reveals that when Jeremiah 29 is a prophecy from God delivered by Jeremiah to the exiles of Israel while they're still in Babylon, it is a promise made to a covenant people, not to the idolatrous nations. So does that mean that we as believers can say God has a plan for us to prosper us and to give us a hope in a future? Yes. But does this mean that the idolatrous lands of Kedar and Hazor were a part of the covenant people? No. So we see that idolatry comes with very serious consequences. Now, the nations in Jeremiah 49 through 50 worshipped idols. We have no idols, or do we? This definition of an idol is an image or representation of a god used as an object of worship. So for everyone who says that we don't worship idols today, we have idols, whether they're in the form of Buddha statues or Egyptian gods or not. And an idol may not seem obvious. For instance, we're looking at the scriptures. What if somebody uses the scriptures to make themselves look good in front of others, to memorize all those scriptures for selfish purposes. That is a form of idolatry. So even something that is seemingly good can be idolatrous if we're not careful.
Mm-hmm.
Who do we put our confidence in? Is it our status, our ability to think, our intellect? Maybe a better question is, who do we put our confidence in? I'd like to pray a prayer that we put our confidence in God and
Excellent.
Come back to the heart of worship.
Thank you.
Dear Jesus, we thank you for this beautiful, wonderful day. Thank you, dear Jesus, for this chapters in the Bible of Jeremiah. And I pray that you will please help us to put our confidence in you and to not look to idolatry, but that we will fully put our trust in you. I pray, dear Jesus, that you will help us to really come to grips with the warnings of Jeremiah, as well as the hope that's presented in Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. So I pray that we will come back to the heart of worship so that we can see what you're doing in our lives and in the lives of those around us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much, Adrian. That was really helpful, educational. And if you are listening to this on Spotify or your favorite platform, I encourage you to go over to our website or to our YouTube channel to see the beautiful and helpful graphics that Skylar has put together to help us put place and people in context. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I really appreciate this this walkthrough and the effort that you put into it, Adrian. So everyone who's joining us, I hope you'll have a good week in readings, even though it's a hard week, and that the Lord will encourage you in his plans for you.
Yes.
And Adrian, we'll see you soon, I hope.
Yes, hope to see you soon.
Okay. Bye, everyone. Bye-bye.